We are live. Welcome to Beastly Thoughts, episode 134.
Beastly. Nailed it.
Beastly. Beastly. Wake up, buddy. We're live, buddy.
Yep. Okay, I'm back. Man, that turkey.
Yeah, lay off that tryptophan, son. Y'all hopped up on that turkey.
That Thanksgiving.
Happy Thanksgiving, man.
Happy Thanksgiving. Happy birthday, Robbie.
Yeah, happy birthday, Robbie. And happy new job, Robbie. Robbie, you got a new job, got a birthday. Everything's going good.
Well, he didn't explain to everybody yet how that those two things combine. He's got to work in his birthday suit at his new job. And there's going to be a lot of tips involved. So congratulations, Robbie.
You know, they got a name for that, don't they?
I don't know what it's called in Canada. I think in Canada it's called gifting. Mm. So they might just be gifting him money there. But congratulations nonetheless, Robbie. Now,
I'm
we know
lost,
in Canada.
Thank you.
Oh, you'll figure it out once that puberty thing happens. Now, in Canada, you guys already had your Thanksgiving. So this is something that we just got through. Lots of football, lots of turkey, lots of cooking. My goodness, Briar, you got to avoid the cooking. I did not.
So much cooking.
Oh. I told my wife by the time I got done cooking, it was like being at work. I might as well have went. It was 8 hours of straight cooking, like a marathon. And I'm so happy it's over. We had a great time. Everybody was full, sleeping, and the madness continues because I still got half of my Thanksgiving food left.
So we had my father and his husband over, and we had, you know, the two boys. So we had six people at our Thanksgiving. And going into it, we were originally going to do Thanksgiving at somebody else's house. So it was like last minute, all of a sudden plans changed. We're going to, and everybody's coming over here. So I'm like, here's what we're going to do. I'm going to give you $60. And you're going to go over to Stop and Shop and buy a Thanksgiving dinner. You ever see these? They're like pre-made Thanksgiving dinners. Right? The turkey is cooked. All you got to do is put it in the oven for like an hour to warm it up. Right? It comes with the stuffing, the mashed potatoes, like squash. I mean, it comes with all the fixings. It's a turkey dinner for six people, ready to go, $60. You can't imagine the pushback I got on that. There is no way that was happening. Like, I thought it was a brilliant plan.
Look, sounds so great.
We cut out on the stress. We don't have the dishes. We don't have to cook all day. Like, this is a great plan. It's perfect.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
No, sir. No, sir. You are not just a fascist, but you are definitely... not getting that bullshit through here. It was not even like...
Hail Stop and Shop.
Yeah, right? I thought it was the best plan. And she's like, no, the turkey, like the flavor's not right on the turkey. I got to make the turkey my own way. And like all the stuffing. And I was like, what are you talking about? Stovetop stuffing either.
I'm sure...
So instead, you know, for 8 hours she cooked and, you know, I helped a little bit. What did I do? I made like, you know, I made the stuffing. I think I did.
Yeah, congratulations.
Yeah, right. I added water.
Did all the work.
Yeah. Hey, made the dinner amazing. Good to amazing because of you.
It doesn't matter who does the majority of the cooking in a married family, okay? I did all the cooking. Your wife did all the cooking. Kate helped too. She skinned some potatoes. And she skinned some sweet potatoes.
I was on PT duty.
She diced some onions for me. I mean, they went perfect with the greens, and she put in her little, you know, plus she's pregnant, too, so she has more of an excuse than you. But I'm happy everybody had a good time. And here we are back. I didn't think I'd make it, man. I've been so full. I've been sliding around on the ground. Have you guys ever seen those dogs that get so fat that when their ass itches, they just spin around on the carpet in circles?
Yeah, sure.
That's how I've been moving around.
I think so. Yeah.
It's been so crazy,
I've been
man.
Just crawling from the back and forth from the refrigerator to the couch, just like crawling back and forth. I eat some turkey, fall asleep, wake up, go get some more turkey, and the process just repeats.
Sounds like a damn good day.
Yeah, wow. it really, really does. And from the guys here to everybody watching, we hope you guys had a great Thanksgiving too. It's always a good time to get around family. And for some of us, we don't really get to see our family that much. Me, I don't get to see my brothers, my sisters, my dad as much as I'd like. And so having everybody come over, my dad, this is one of the first years he didn't cook. So having everybody come over and taste my food and say how wonderful it was, because I knew it was. And just having that family, you know, that of course it was. It's beastly. And having everybody around watching TV and just having a good time. Thanksgiving is always great. And in some ways, to me, it's even better than Christmas because everybody isn't looking for gifts. You're just there to share a meal and share a conversation. And it was really, really great. I hope everybody out there
is the same. There's less stress. Some holidays are just so stressful, right? It's like, and Christmas can get like that. It's like, you know, did I get the right gift for this person? You know, like that kind of thing. Or, you know, the gift that I really want to get is too expensive or sold out or, you know, like that kind of thing can be really stressful. But with Thanksgiving, I suppose there's some stress with the cooking of the meal and the cleaning up after. But it feels like it's just a holiday where it's just about like getting everybody together to have a, you know, a good meal together. And I like that about it.
Yeah, it sounds like you guys had a good time too. Now, I'm sure that your dad, his husband, the kids, and your lovely wife enjoyed the home-cooked meal a lot more than the $60 package, I'm sure. I mean, I've heard some stories about those turkeys.
Yeah.
You know, some people say they taste like the toy turkey. You know, sometimes they're a little more gummy than you like. Looks like you're eating Laffy Taffy. So I'm happy that, you know, you guys went the traditional route and cooked it up. Now I got a question for you guys. After Thanksgiving comes one of the biggest shopping days of the year.
Mm-hmm.
And it's an insane time to get out and try your hand at rolling the dice to get maybe an item you've seen online or in the paper that you just got to have. I actually tried it. We went all out, missed every sale that we wanted.
Oh, no. But
it was pathetic. I went to five places looking for Kate's Nintendo 3DS, the $100 Black Friday.
Oh, yeah. I think it was like not anywhere. Yeah.
It wasn't any. Look, man, I'm talking early. We went out Thursday night, like at 6 o'clock that night, to see if like Walmart was going to, we're going to be releasing them at midnight. I was like, I'm not going to be doing this at midnight. I come back the next day, go there, GameStop, Toys R Us, they're all like, haha, you're like 8 hours late, motherfucker. I'm like, what? I just want the 3DS.
It's nearly obsolete game system. I can't be sold out.
Just give them to me.
Nintendo made a killing. Let me tell you that those things were all. They said it was one of the first things that sold out. So
between that you and guys, the NES Classic Edition, it's like Nintendo is like they can't keep things on shelves except for Wii U's, of course. But,
I wonder why. You know, I would gladly take my Wii U back to a store and put it on the shelf and wait for someone to buy it.
Can I trade you for a NES Classic, please?
Absolutely.
Take my Wii U.
Nintendo makes a killing by releasing limited amounts, and that drives up the hysteria. You know, people want them even worse because you hear you can't get them. Mm-hmm. And so,
who could have thought, though? Who would have imagined, like, that there'd be a supply constraint on, like, these two items? I guess you could have seen it for the NES Classic, but I would have never suspected for a 3DS.
Yeah.
I would have never suspected for a 3DS that there'd be that amount of hype about it, you know?
I mean, we went out.
I guess it was.
And while we were out shopping, looking for it, of course, picking up some other things, picked up a few games and stuff. She was on her phone. We came back home. She's on her laptop and on her iPad trying to find out who might still have it. We're going down to Fayetteville, driving downtown, trying to see if any of these places have it. And they were completely gone. So Nintendo did make a killing on those 3DS deals. And more than likely, these are just their backlog. They reskinned them, put these little stickers on them, and sold them because they know that Switch is coming. It's a quick extra $100.
Yeah, that's why I was so surprised. Is why would you be so excited for a 3DS right now when the Switch is right around the corner?
Well, see me. I'm an equal opportunity gamer, right? And see my wife. She's a low maintenance type of gamer. If she can play mine or play Nova's or Nina, even my 3-year-old has a 3DS. So she'll play somebody else's just to get her fix. You know, inject it right into the vein. And so instead of doing that, I was like, you're the only person. There's six people in the house. You're the only person with a 3DS. This is a great time to pick it up. She's probably beat more 3DS games on my 3DS than I have. So I was like, man, I got an extra $100. Just throw it your way. Grab it for you. And she went for it. She's like, oh, cool. I'm happy about that. And so when she told me she wanted it, I was like, we're definitely going to get this. And, of course, I was let down. So
did you go ahead and buy like the full price one? Because how much is a full price one now? It's like $120.
No, they're $179.
Are they really? Oh, that's a big discount. Yeah. Okay, now I get it.
Yeah,
I didn't think it was a big discount.
Yeah, they're still up there. When I bought my XL a few months back, my new XL, that was $200 new. That was a few months ago, and I bought that gray XL. And so we were out there braving the storm trying to get this thing. Unfortunately, we didn't find it. But I was able to find a few stragglers on eBay that actually bought this $99 3DS, and now they're $270, so I passed on that as well.
Oh my god. Good god.
Insane.
I went to a little shopping, too. Something you said
a few minutes ago. Yeah, tell me all about it.
I didn't go out of the house to do it. I went the Steam Autumn Sale is up and running, so a lot of the games that I've been kind of looking, had my eye on, are actually heavily discounted right now on Steam.
Right now?
Yep. Yeah, and since I now have a gaming PC, you know, like a brand new gaming PC, I thought, hey, you know, I'll pick up some of these games. One of those games was Doom, which is one that I saw come out early this year, and I said, you know what? I'm planning on buying a PC sometime this year. That, to me, is a PC game. Like, Doom just computes to me because I played it all those years ago on a PC, like the original. To me, it just computes as a PC game. So this was a perfect opportunity because it was only $20 on Steam. So I was like, you know, fuck it. I'm buying Doom. I loaded it up on the PC. God damn, that game is awesome.
Yeah, it sure is.
It's without a doubt my favorite game of the year. I'll tell you that right now. Like, it's unbelievably fun. I haven't played any of the multiplayer yet. I haven't played any of the create a map kind of stuff yet, but I've heard some amazing stories of what people have created in there. Awesome. But just the campaign, the speed and the frenetic gameplay and the fact that you have to go get health pickups and armor pickups and
love that.
You know, it feels so much like Doom. The fact that you're running around getting key cards, or you know, you have this level that you have to explore and kind of like use your map to figure out, okay, I haven't been there yet. Got to figure out what's going on. How do I open this door? How do I, like, it just feels like fucking Doom, man. It feels exactly like Doom.
Yeah.
But there's all of this modern stuff on it too. You know, like you can upgrade your weapons, you can upgrade your armor, you can upgrade your abilities. You get double jump, you start to build up your character in a very modern way, which is a lot of fun, and it feels like you're progressing, your character. And the story's a lot of fun, too. It's not, you know, some kind of, like, it's not an Uncharted or a Last of Us type story, or, you know, but it's a fun enough story that you feel you're interested to see where it's going to go, right? And I haven't finished it yet, and I am. I'm definitely interested to see where it's going to go. But I got to tell you, the game looks fucking amazing. Like, it's one of the best looking games I've ever played. And I want to see, this is id Tech 6, right?
Yep. Yeah.
This is the engine they're using. I want to see this engine used for like everything. I want to see Destiny get a hold of this engine. I want to see like every game developed use this engine, because it runs like a dream. It runs at 60 frames per second on, like, you know, like your Casio calculator. You know, and it looks amazing. It's just, I mean, it's a beautiful game. The way they've melded exactly what was fun with the original Doom and Doom 2, but also modernized it. It was something they completely fucked up in Doom 3.
Yep.
Yeah.
You know, but they absolutely nailed it here.
He's right. The Berserks, all the pickups from the original Doom and Doom 2 are there.
Yeah.
When you can, like, you know, get invincibility, the Berserker barrage, where you run around and punching enemies.
Oh
the
my god, that's so much fun.
The insta kills, or I'm trying, they're called they're not called
glory insta kills.
Glory kills.
Yeah.
When you go up to these enemies, they turn blue, and you like grab them and do this crazy kind of rip their head open. It's so beautiful, and you see all the ammunition come flying out of them. Yeah. They've added a whole new way for something old, which was the chainsaw. It looks great in this game when you use it, but when you use that and you kill an enemy, all this ammunition comes out. So if you're running low on ammo, they found a new way for you to use that and make sense.
It incentivizes you to like keep switching up what you're gonna do. Like, glory kills will definitely get you life back. So if you're running low on life, you want to use a glory kill. But if you're running low on ammo, you definitely want to use a chainsaw, because that's going to provide you ammo. So you want to be switching back and forth between these things so you don't run out of life and you don't run out of ammo. It's really a genius system.
Out of all the first-person shooters I've seen this year, I remember telling you guys this earlier in the year when I played Doom, beat it, and reviewed it. And that review is still up on the channel, so check it out. It was my favorite first-person shooter of the year, and probably for the past few years. And even till now, I haven't seen anything that even reached that bar or even came close to it. Doom on consoles is, in my mind, what I expected Doom to be on a great PC. On the PS4, at 60 frames per second, never never, you know, hits a speed bump. It's perfect frame rate. The speed is so fluent. You feel like you're on skates, you know, how fast a character moves. It's just so smooth. It reminds you of the original Doom and Doom 2. That same feeling of frantic, frenetic gameplay is just translated so well into a modern game. And that's something that a lot of developers miss. A lot of developers take a great old franchise. Hey, we're going to make it new again. We're going to add all this new stuff. But they forget to add the stuff that made it great in the first place.
Yeah.
That's not the case here. Everything that made Doom great and made Doom 2 great is translated to the new Doom with all this new stuff that really builds more meat on the bone for the game. I totally agree with you. It's definitely Game of the Year contender.
It's an
excellent game. Excellent.
One of my favorite things is when I realized that the shift button actually slows your character down to a walk. Like, because you're basically sprinting all the time. So, like, the button that you would hit normally to, like, speed up your character, it's like, it does the exact opposite. I thought that was hilarious. Like, there's no reason to use it that I've seen. It's just funny that it's there. It works great. I plugged in a controller as well. It works great on a controller. It doesn't really matter if you're playing on mouse and keyboard. I'm trying to play on mouse and keyboard because I want to get that skill back that I had all those years ago, where when I used to play Quake and Quake 3 and, like, you know, all those online shooters. I used to be decent with the mouse and keyboard, and I'm not anymore. Like, that skill has completely disappeared. So in anticipation of possibly having Destiny 2 come out on PC, it'd be nice if I wasn't, like, starting from scratch with a mouse and keyboard again. It's been fun, like, just like relearning mouse and keyboard. It's a fast way to aim in a shooter. It does feel good. I was talking to Gary, who's in chat, like, maybe I'll get one of these things for the PS4 as well. One of these adapters, you know? One of these little cheat adapters. Get me a mouse and keyboard going and on a PS4.
That would be nuts. It'd give you all, but then again, it'd be like the same analogy you use with the scuff. Is it cheating? Absolutely, and you highly recommend it.
Yeah.
So, yeah. Exactly what you said about the scuff.
Go ahead and do it.
Go ahead and be a dick.
I've never been, you know, the PC guy. I've never used the mouse and keyboard. I've done it with DayZ. I did it with Tomb Raider for my PC. I'm in my mid-30s, closer to 40 than 30. And I feel like it's a new skill to learn. And somehow it's something I feel I'll never get good at. I missed that boat. You know, when everybody was playing with PCs, I was still in Super Nintendo, not giving a damn.
I don't believe in that old dog, new tricks bullshit. I think it's never too late to learn something.
You just changed my mind, Brian. I'm going to play mouse and keyboard tonight.
Yeah, it's so much faster. It's so much faster. So I also been playing. So this is a little bit embarrassing, but I bought another copy of The Division. It's the third copy I bought. All right, so I already had bought it. I was so hyped for this game when it came out that I immediately bought it for the Xbox and the PlayStation, right?
Me too.
I was psyched for this game. I honestly thought it was going to be a game for me similar to Destiny that I just play constantly forever, right? And I was sorely disappointed. But The Division got their update, 1.4, I think it is, where they changed up a lot of stuff. They added a very cool survival mode for a multiplayer mode. And I definitely wanted to check it out again. Of course, I got the new PC, and I was thinking, you know, I'll check it out on PC. And it was also on sale from Steam. You could get, like, the Ultimate Gold Edition with all the DLC and the Season Pass and all that bullshit for, I think it was $40, which is a nice deal for all of that. It's like an $80 value, right? Or it was at launch. So I bought that, downloaded it. Holy goddamn, that game ran like hot trash on my computer. I returned it on Steam. Yeah. Every time I booted the damn game up, it would run like in 3/4 of the screen. So it was up on like the top left of the screen up here. It wouldn't actually full up the screen. So like I go on online, I'm like, how do you fix this? And everybody's got a way to fix it. You got to go into like the config files and start, you know, open them up with Notepad and start typing shit into the config files.
Oh, God.
And like that fixed it for a while. And then the next time I tried to reboot it, it's like, oh shit, it's broken again. It doesn't run. Oh man, there was like, I had like 6 major problems with the game running on my PC. And I know that other people don't have all these problems, but I was on the forums and a lot of people are having these problems. So that was the first time I ever took advantage of Steam's return policy. I was like, fuck this. I put, I want to say 6 hours on Saturday just into getting the division running. And I was mad. I was mad. And that, and I'm like, the whole time, I'm like, this is the third fucking time I bought this game. Why am I doing this? The third fucking time I bought it. And like, here I am. Like, I didn't even like it the first two times I bought it. Why did I buy it the third time? And now I'm spending 6 hours on Thanksgiving weekend devoted to just making this stupid ass game run. So I returned it.
This time you could have been playing Destiny, bro.
Right?
You know?
Well, I've been playing some other games too. I'm not done yet.
You could have ran a raid.
I could have run a few of them. Well, it depends on the. I had a
don't
raid.
Don't get him started.
I had a raid on Thursday. I don't even want to talk about it.
Let's not get him started.
So I also have just about finished off Uncharted 4. Finally, I've been playing a lot of games because I've had a lot of free time.
Yeah, I for one want to applaud that, Briar.
Yeah,
because you've been going all out. You know, all year Briar didn't play anything but Destiny. Yeah, like the last 2 months, he's trying to play 500 games. Way to go, man! You're getting them too.
So I gotta say, I really like Uncharted 4. I really like the story. I really like what they do between the characters. Kind of like it's not all sunshine and roses in this world between all the characters. There is some real emotional impact to some of the decisions that Nate and others make. And I think that's really fun. I got to say this, though. The formula of the Uncharted game of, you know, climbing, then shooting, then climbing, then shooting, is getting a bit old for me. It doesn't quite have the excitement that it had in Uncharted 1 or Uncharted 2. They never really made that shooting fun. Like, it always feels like something I just got to get through to get to the next cutscene. You know what I mean? Yep. They never made that shooting fun. I think it's better in this game than it has been because there's, like, a lot of cover and you're kind of, like, bouncing around on platforms and stuff while you're shooting. But whenever I'm in a shooting sequence, I do one of two things. I either just go balls out and just try and get through it as fast as I can so I can just get through it. Or I try and sneak around and stealth kill everybody just so I don't have to interact with the shooting mechanics. Like, I don't think that's intended, right? There's something wrong there.
It's certainly not.
There's something wrong there. And the climbing was so exciting, right? You're always like exploring these like buildings or you're climbing up these mountains or, you know, whatever you're doing, whatever you're climbing up. It was so cool in the first couple of Uncharted games. And even in Uncharted 3, they still found ways for it to make it for me to like feel like, oh my God, like these butt clenching moments where I'm like, oh my God, he's gonna fall, you know, like
yeah.
But it feels so similar to how it's been, even though it looks better, even though I think it's animated better. I think they just need to move that series on somehow. Maybe make that more of a skill based thing where you actually have to. There are a couple of times where you gotta, you know, do some pretty quick button presses, but for the most part, you're just like steering him up a wall and he's like, you know, slithering his way up. But to me, it's all worth it. You know, it's worth some of the boredom of the actual gameplay because like the graphics and the set pieces and like the designs of like, you know, these big epic moments. No other game makes me feel like I'm Indiana Jones more than the Uncharted series.
Absolutely.
Like it nails it so hard. Like, it doesn't matter if you're, like, jumping from the back of one pickup truck into a Jeep and, like, knocking out the driver so that you can take over his Jeep. Or if you're, you know, you're swinging across a ravine and, you know, grabbing a guy by the ankle and yanking him off a ledge. Like, there's just something that nails that feel of an action movie so well that it just continually makes me want to play. And the story is fantastic too. So it's like,
yeah, the story really is.
But I really wish that they would update their gameplay. The shooting mechanics and the climbing mechanics, I feel like need to kind of move on a little bit.
Yeah.
Well, we'll see what they do after this game. I don't know how they're going to. I don't think that the Uncharted series will be over after this. Of course, we know this is the end of Nathan's story. And no spoilers for those who haven't beat the game. But I feel that at some point in time, there will be another Uncharted game, and hopefully they can touch upon those requests whenever that development begins. I loved Uncharted 4. It's definitely a game of the year contender. You know, really big possibility of that game being game of the year. But I had a great time with it. I'm happy you're enjoying it. And let us know how you feel after you beat the game, because that might kind of, it's going to kind of tie it up and put a nice bow on it for you. I want to see your reaction to that.
Yeah, there will certainly be another Uncharted game. I don't think Naughty Dog will ever do another one, but I definitely feel like Sony will get someone to do it. I think there will be.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. And so, Briar, was that what you've been playing this week?
Or well, I've been playing a little bit more Witcher 3, but I kind of want to... Have you guys been playing that as well? Everybody was kind of thinking they were going to jump back into that game.
I turned it on.
You turned it on? That's it? That's as far as you got?
Yeah.
It's a start.
Now, the reason I didn't get too into it is because I turned it on at a time where I had two new games. Mm-hmm. And I was like, I've already put in 15 or 20 hours, but I want to see at least see what this looks like. And then when I put one of the games in, I saw what it looked like. I got sucked into it for like the last 3 days straight. So it's been consuming my time. I apologize.
All right. Maybe we'll couch that conversation till maybe the new year when we have a little more time without all these. It just seems like there's brand new games coming out all the time. And I'm playing catch up on all these games that I haven't even, you know, all these great games. Yeah. You know, I still want to play a lot more Titanfall 2. I still want to play Battlefield 1. I haven't even touched that game yet. I'm really looking forward to it.
So good.
And you know, there's oh god damn, I played Infinite Warfare too.
Oh
fuck that game, man.
Oh really?
Oh god. It looks great. You know, and I think it's good for a Call of Duty campaign. I think. But man, I'm just so over Call of Duty's like style of campaign where it's, you know, move to an area, get behind cover, shoot to get bad guys, kill them all, wait for another group of them to respawn, shoot all of them, wait for another group to respawn. You know, they're on this like endless spawn timer, and shoot all of them, and then move to the next set piece, and then shoot all the bad guys, and then wait for them to respawn. You know, it's just over and cyclical and cyclical and cyclical. That shit worked for me in Call of Duty and in Call of Duty 2. In Modern Warfare, it was obscured by the fact that they had changed everything about the series. But even in Modern Warfare 2, it was very apparent what they were doing. And by the time like Modern Warfare 3 and the rest, Black Ops 2, and like basically from there on, like I have not played any of the Call of Duty campaigns because it's just a boring thing to do.
Yeah.
And this one is the boringest. Wow. Man, it was like, after so many people had talked so...
I remember you saying how excited you were.
I was. Like, everybody, like, it looks fantastic. I love, like, the space theme and the ship battle, I think is cool. But, man, it's just that same old Call of Duty where you're just like, forward 10 steps, shoot fucking men for 20 minutes, move forward 10 steps, like... God damn, I've been doing this for fucking 15 years. I'm done. I don't want to do that anymore.
I totally hear you.
I got a question. Totally gotcha. I'm going to play devil's advocate here. Now, shooting people in shooting games is ubiquitous across shooting games. Mm-hmm. What kind of changes would you like to see? Now, I know, would you like to see maybe some more stealth sections? Maybe interrogation.
No, there's just other ways you can handle shooting games. Look at what Doom's doing. Look at what Destiny's doing. There's like, look at even Halo. Even though Halo's been going on for 5 sequels, it still feels like a fresher experience than these. It's just this one method of designing these campaigns where you just, like, you literally go into an area and then, like, the enemies are all behind cover. Right. You got to hide behind cover. They're behind cover. You shoot them all. And then, you know, maybe you move up a few steps. Maybe you wait because there's a bunch more coming in. You know, you got the guy, your commander talking to you on comms, which doesn't make any fucking sense because you're the captain of the ship. You should be the one doing the commanding. I don't know. Yeah, you know, Daryl Dova's in chat saying Titanfall 2. Yeah, that's a perfect example. It's like, you know, those are the guys who made up this type of
gameplay,
and they moved on, but Call of Duty is still kind of set in its ways. And for all the accolades this single player got, man, it could not hook me at all. Like, I just
wow,
yeah, Oh man,
Robbie was all over. He was all over the nuts of this game's campaign. Robbie, are you trying to lead us and the viewers astray? What's going on here?
Why would you do that to us, Robbie?
I mean, you know, with age comes wisdom. With age comes wisdom. So you know what to believe Briar 100% more than a young chucklehead like yourself. There's a blow pop in your back pocket. I know it.
There are different strokes for different folks. I could do that. Yeah.
This is something I'm probably going to end up trying. And let me just say this about Titanfall 2. I'm continually hearing great things about that game. Within the next couple days, I'll have Titanfall 2. I'm really excited about that. I wish I saw it during my Black Friday experiences. But I'm definitely getting that. That's probably the shooter I'm most excited for right now. Just for the things I'm hearing as far as the multiplayer goes and the campaign. And, of course, it's something different. I don't want the same old, same old. I don't want, you know, the same Battlefield experience. I don't want the same Call of Duty experience. I want something that's so far out of the box that it just feels fresh to me. And from what I'm hearing from lots and lots of people on my YouTube channel, other YouTube channels, people talking to me about it, it's really a refreshing experience.
It is. It does feel fresh.
Probably within the next couple of days, I'll have it. I'll have it definitely by the time we do the show next week.
You know,
looking forward to that.
You definitely didn't hurt yourself by waiting a few weeks to buy it either, because it's like discounted by like half price all over the place.
Oh like, man, I'm getting some mad discounts right now.
Yeah, for
baby.
A game that's so brand new, it's like it's amazing how discounted that game is.
Yeah.
My brother actually got a nice Black Friday deal. His wife brought him a PlayStation VR his PS4. He got the PlayStation, and he's been out of the loop for a long time. His last console that he just went crazy over was Super Nintendo. As a matter of fact, for the last couple of years, that's the number one console he comes over here to borrow from me, is the fucking Super Nintendo. He'll come in, he'll see all these consoles, he'll say, well, just give me the Super Nintendo, Super Castlevania,
you know there's Mario a new Kart. One of these, right?
Yeah, I don't know what's going on with the guy, but yeah, he got the PlayStation 4 Pro on the 10th, and he's just been super excited about that, got a 4K TV, and he called me the last night and said that his wife, he asked his wife to go out and pick him up The Last of Us for PS4, and she didn't do it. And he said when she came back in the house, he was working on her phone, he saw her come in, she didn't have it, so he told me he felt a little depressed. And then she sat down and asked him to go get her clothes out of the washer and put them in the dryer, and like the bitch that he is, he went to do it, and he went into the laundry room, and there it was, a PlayStation 4 Pro, VR on top of the washing machine. Amazing story. Mm-hmm. And so he called me. He was so excited.
That he is.
That's right.
What a description.
Sure, honey. You didn't get my game, but I'm going to go take your laundry out of the washing machine. But it was an amazing thing. Older brother is super happy about it. His wife is awesome for doing that for him. But she didn't get him a camera, so he got the camera.
Oh, he didn't have a camera to use it?
So he looked at it like, and he had two Move controllers, and he kept calling me last night, well, the Move controllers from the PS3 work. I said, they're the only Move controllers, Joe. Are you sure? I said, God damn it, Joe.
Trust me, yes, he knows
the only ones that work.
Yes.
So she got him that.
God damn it, Joe, you bitch ass. Get your shit together.
That's going a little far.
Fucking Joe, man. Brother. Fucking get Joe.
Get your shit together.
And dad named him after him. He named me Joe. Shit. I had the PS4 for years.
Get shit together, Joe.
God damn it, Joe. Get your shit together.
Joe, come on. Tell mama you, Joe. All right, so, what have I been playing for the last couple of days? Let's talk about video games. During the Black Friday extravaganza that was people flipping in and out of Walmarts and Best Buys, I came across two games that I bought. One was Dishonored 2, and the other was Skyrim Remastered for PS4. Mm-hmm. I have not played Skyrim Remastered at all. I didn't put it in. Unfortunately, I put in Dishonored 2, and nothing has left my PS4 since that moment. I was watching it. It did. And Dishonored 2... I believe you are Empress Emily. That's a crazy name. It just sounds so real. Emily, you are this empress or like queen over this nation, and your protector is actually your father. Yep. And I guess he was the guy from the original Dishonored game. And this is 15 years after. Yeah, yeah. I knew you'd know. You fucking 13-year-old. You know everybody's name. What's my middle name, Robbie? I know you know it. What's my social security? You know all this shit. But
I don't know
anyway,
if I know that,
you end up you end up getting deposed. Someone comes to your to your castle, to your village or whatever, your town, or I don't know, Imperial City. I don't know what it'd be called, but someone came there and said that they're the rightful heir to your throne. You get deposed. And then she turns around and she says, I'm the new fucking queen. Fuck this bitch, Emily. And then everybody, all your guards and everybody turn on you. You're like, what's happening? It's left the end. And so everybody locks me, locks you up. They basically free
Joe. Joe, man.
God damn it. Joe. If you just had the camera, Joe, the camera, everything would have been all right. So they encase your father in basically carbonite like Han Solo, this woman does, and they imprison you. And the whole purpose of the game is to get out, find out all these people inside the hierarchy who work for you, who basically decided to stab you in the back and allow this other person to usurp power as you pursue the throne. The game is incredible. It reminds me of the way I felt.
Let me ask you. I don't like stealth games. Would I like this game?
Yes.
Okay.
Because it's not stealth. What I was just getting ready to say, do you remember the first time you played Crysis?
Yeah.
Crysis 2 was the first Crysis game I ever played.
I played it at one frame per second. Very hard to play.
Damn. Holy shit. It took you 2 years to beat the game. The thing about this game that's really unique is it is a stealth game, but it doesn't have to be. It affords the player myriad ways to approach gameplay. You can run in there, run and gun. You have a gun, you have a sword. And basically, if you time your parries, you can kill every enemy with one hit. So you can run and gun. You have a very powerful like shotgun. It's badass. All these weapons are upgradable. And on top of that, you get these, I think they're called bone shards or spirit shards that you find throughout the world that allow you to do things like upgrade your mana, your health. If you go into water, you can basically get all your stuff back. It all depends on the ones that you equip at the same time. You can have up to 12 at one time. I've already found 20. So nobody's going to play the game in the same way. It's so many different ways that you can play this game. Yeah, it's really, really an incredible game. It's a beautiful game. I'm having a lot of fun playing it. There are certain areas where you have to play stealthily because there's like 5 or 6 people. But even then, you can go in, throw a grenade, fuck shit up, and go in there and cut people's heads off. And it has what is equivalent to these glory kills from Doom, Briar. When you run up on people and you can mesmerize people. You can use magic. You can teleport. You can mesmerizing people. You throw like this obelisk out in front of you, and it spins around, and it's black, and it looks beautiful. I can't believe it's on PS4. But when the enemies see it, they get mesmerized, and they're standing there looking at it. And you run up to them, just slice their damn head off. It's like, oh, wow, it's really incredible. You can take over animals, and they can go behind doors and things to open them up for you. You can control enemies. It's just so many different things you can do, very similar to the original. And unfortunately, I didn't beat the original game. But so far, I'm really enjoying it. I got to say, I probably put 8 hours in so far. Everybody in my house is watching me play it. Dishonored 2 is a really, really good game. If you guys haven't tried it, I would say definitely check it out. It is a stealth-based action game, but you don't have to play it stealthily. You can run and gun it. You can run and slice them. And there's tons of ways that you can go about attacking your foes. And the thing that makes this game really reminds me of Crysis is there's the verticality in it. There's so many different places that you can go. Like you can look up on a ledge, you can teleport there, even if people are chasing you. And then when you get up there, you just crouch and they don't know where you went. It's just so many different things you can do. It's a great game. I'm really happy I picked it up.
Sounds like a bunch of bling shotgunners in this game.
Baby scum.
Yeah, I mean,
you know, you just shortened the whole stint. That's all I had to say.
But I love Dishonored. I'm gonna say that, man. Oh, the first one was so good. Like that game is so sick. It is the stealth game for people who do not like stealth games because you just have the coolest friggin' powers and like you just. Oh my god, that game is so satisfying. I love the first one.
I've only unlocked.
You play the second one yet, Robbie?
No, but I'm absolutely getting it.
I've only unlocked 3 of her main powers so far. I think there's like 10. I've only unlocked 3. I've got this ability to see through walls and see where enemies are and which directions that they're walking. Sure. So if they come around and I stab them in their back, they turn into ash. I've got another one that's like a heart. You hold it in your hand, and it takes you to basically where these bone shards are in the world because it's an open-world game. And once you find those, they give you more of an ability to upgrade your weapons and your abilities. Yep. And the last one is the teleport. And I'm getting getting ready to upgrade that now. Right now I can teleport pretty much anywhere, but the next upgrade for that power is to be able to grab people and items and yank them to me. So it's a lot going on in this game. It looks beautiful. It runs really, really well. And I didn't know I'd like it as much as I did. I didn't even put Skyrim in. I know I love Skyrim. I just want to see what that looks like. But I'll probably end up beating this game before I even put Skyrim in. It's a really fun game.
That's cool.
Robbie, what the hell have you been playing in Canada? I know you guys had a sleepover and stuff on Thanksgiving for your birthday. And it was a jammy jam party. That's what we do when we're 13.
With alcohol, yeah.
What have you been playing this week, though?
Yeah, clearly because I turned 13, obviously we're drinking all night. Yeah, makes sense.
I don't know about the alcohol laws in Canada. I didn't know you could drink that young. But what have you been playing this week?
I hate you guys. It's fine.
Rob, you know we're going to mess with you. When you turn 25, I'm going to still call you 15. Go ahead, my friend.
Haven't really been playing much this week. I mean, I got some really good deals on Black Friday, though. I got, I just picked up the Phantom Pain for $15, which I was so happy about. I got Assassin's Creed Syndicate for $20. A bunch of my friends bought Dark Souls 3 for $25, so I bought it again for Xbox One. I'm looking forward to playing through with them. Man, Black Friday deals are amazing, but yeah, so I haven't been playing much.
Is this your first time getting the Phantom Pain, or?
Yeah, I haven't played it yet. I'm looking forward to it. I mean, $15. I couldn't pass it up when I saw it.
Yeah, that's a great deal.
Yeah.
I would just tell everybody out there to keep your eyes on the Xbox Lives, the Xbox Store, the PlayStation Store. They got insane sales going on.
Yeah.
I bought two or three other lesser-known games on my PS4 last night. I can't remember them. I bought the Mega Man Collection. It was $6. I bought Wolfenstein, the DLC. What's it called, guys?
The Old Blood.
Yeah.
I bought that. I think it was $5 or $6.
Oh,
you know,
that's awesome.
for the Black Friday sale, and I haven't played that yet. So definitely keep your eyes on those stores. My wife, unfortunately, was looking on Nintendo's 3DS store, but she didn't get a 3DS, so she stopped watching.
Yeah, I gotta say, Best Buy especially had awesome game sales. I mean, definitely check that out. I think
Amazon it would end like tomorrow. So.
Yeah, Amazon's good. Best Buy is good. Been really good though.
All right, so Thanksgiving's over, Black Friday's over, Cyber Monday's coming, and we got some video gaming news for you guys on Beastly Thoughts, episode 134. Robbie, would you like to get us started?
Absolutely. Let's do it. So, first bit of news this week. What's so funny?
I was laughing at Briar's face. It was great.
Oh, okay. Anyways, guys, so this week Ubisoft has provided a statement claiming Watch Dogs 2's first week of sales are comparatively lower than that of the first game, but it also has a much more positive critical reception. Doesn't really surprise me either way.
Yeah, that makes perfect sense to me.
It does.
The fact that Watch Dogs 2 ended up being good is like the most shocking story of 2016. I mean, and let's be honest, Trump got elected.
So anything's possible now.
The fact that Watch Dogs 2 ended up being good, I mean, like, blindsided me. I just assumed it was gonna be garbage like the first one. But yeah, I want to play that game, and I would assume that a lot of people had the same bad taste in their mouths that I did from Watch Dogs 1, so they didn't go out and pre-order it. They didn't,
you guys,
you know, they wanted to see reviews, and now they're hearing that it's good from a lot of reviewers, so they're like, oh, I'll go pick this up.
Yeah, well, that's my reaction. If you guys remember last week, I was really, really shocked when both of you had told me that Watch Dogs 2 was a good game. To me, that was like earth-shattering news. I couldn't believe it because the first one was so shitty. But the thing is, I don't want this to turn into a cult classic. They need to find a way to turn this around now. You know, there are really great things out there that are critically acclaimed but commercial failures. And we don't need to let a game that's actually good fall into that category. So hopefully word of mouth spreads fast. I don't want this to turn into like a 28 Days Later or a movie or something that's really good critically but commercially flopping. If this game is actually as good as a lot of people are saying it is, you know, word of mouth needs to get out there so people can pick it up and support good development, because it doesn't happen every day that Ubisoft makes a great game.
And the Division, man.
That one just got away. Yeah.
Moving forward, Ubisoft has announced that the company will no longer be charging for DLC in any of its future titles that impact players' core experience in any way, such as multiplayer, maps, and modes. Wow.
Yeah, I didn't hear about this, but I saw that, and I was like, this is big. I even know that.
What? So, wow. No more DLC for multiplayer maps or modes. No, it'll all be free from this point on for all Ubisoft games. Man, that's huge news.
That's huge.
Yeah, that's really good news. And I mean, I think a so lot no of season publishers passes? No, I don't think so for the most part, unless it's like, you know, maybe single player more stuff. But I mean, this is awesome. I think a lot of publishers have been moving in this direction. EA with Titanfall 2, their maps are free. The only one that hasn't done it yet, Activision, I'm looking at you with Call of Duty. Yeah. Seriously, your map packs are bloody overpriced. Cut that shit out.
It's I mean, for the most part, if you think about
it, we're getting good.
Because what happens when you start selling DLCs, and this happens to Call of Duty, it happens to Destiny, all these games that have been doing this for a long time, is that you're splitting your player base into all these segments. Mm-hmm. You got,
yeah,
you know, especially after like time goes on and you've got like multiple of these things. I was like, maybe you got a guy who's got, you know, the base game and map pack one, but didn't buy map pack two, so he can't play with the people who have map pack one and map pack two. Maybe you got a guy who's got, you know, the base game and then only bought map pack three, so he can't play with a guy who bought map pack one, map pack two, and map pack three. Like, there's all these like different segments that happen because, you know, they're charging for these things. But if you have them for free, then you can assume that everybody's got all the map packs. You can make all your playlists have all the map packs in it. All the maps, all the new weapons, all that stuff can be in every playlist, as opposed to having, here's a playlist for DLC 1, here's a playlist for DLC 2. Like, it's just fucking stupid how it like segments your population. It is so dumb. So this is brilliant. Unfortunately, they are going to have to pay for this somehow. You know that. And that
there's going to be some somehow, sort of DLC. Yeah.
It's going to it's going to be microtransactions. It's always microtransactions.
Yeah,
they make so much more money off of the microtransactions anyway. But ultimately, I think it's probably smarter. But they just got to make sure.
I mean, I don't mind buying skins or, you know, emotes and things like that to add a little bit of flavor to my character. I mean, I don't have any issue with that, especially if the DLC is free. You don't feel like you're taking that much of a hit.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think this is a great idea. And hopefully more companies will follow suit with Ubisoft's idea to kind of abolish this pay-to-play when it comes to DLC, especially in multiplayer-centered games.
Yeah. Absolutely. But you can definitely expect to see
I think it's a great idea.
Microtransactions on their way, like in a big way to pay.
Maybe, more of an emphasis.
And, it, you know, it's a dangerous slope because we've seen it in Destiny. Like, all of a sudden, you get a little too heavy on the microtransactions, and your whole community starts, you know, getting really pissed off.
Questioning your, The next little bit of news is a little heart-wrenching to me. A brief listing on Target seems to confirm the Legend of Zelda Breath of the Wild release date for June 13, 2017. The listing has since been taken down, but heavily suggests the game will not be done in time for the launch of the Nintendo Switch.
That's bad news. But if they had Mario come out with the launch and then Zelda in the summer...
I'd be okay with
Mario,
that.
Mario, that's their big... I mean, real talk, Mario is Nintendo's biggest IP. If they release a good Mario game with that thing, the way they did with the Nintendo 64, with the Super Nintendo, come on, baby. If they bring that out and it's an awesome Mario game, that's all people are going to want to play. Playing it on the go, playing it at home, playing it butt naked. It's going to be fucking amazing. As long as that game comes out with launch, I'm going to be happy with the Switch.
Done deal, son.
I'll wait.
Done fucking deal.
It actually makes a lot of sense. Because if they release Mario and Zelda at launch, then, you know, people, hardcore gamers are going to be happy. But, like, more casual players who don't have time to play, you know, for 4 hours a day, they're not going to be able to play both of those games. So one of those games is going to get overlooked. But if they come out with Mario at launch, then Zelda in the summertime, holy shit, you're just coming right off of Mario into Zelda. Like, that's a pretty strong 1-2 punch right there.
Yeah, hopefully they're getting their lineup ready, because they've got some really, really popular IPs. I know some of them aren't as popular as others, like Metroid, but if they can start getting these things ready and start, you know, with announcements, letting people know, hey, look, we're serious about our IPs, we got third parties coming, Nintendo Switch is going to be a huge success. I can't wait to see it. Blizzard Entertainment has posted a new job listing this week for a lead software engineer to work on an unannounced first-person project. Dun-dun. First-person Blizzard? Could this be more games like Overwatch?
That seems to be what this has to do with. Something similar to that, because that was their first game they've ever made, right? In first person, would be Overwatch. So, I mean, they did a hell of a job. Overwatch is a really good game. So
turns out those guys are pretty good at what they do.
Well,
turns out they make really damn good video games. It happens for years and years.
Who would have thought? You
who
know?
Knew? Blizzard made amazing games.
That there was a post-mortem. I can't remember where I read it, but basically, it was an interview with the developers of Overwatch, and that game came out of the failed development of a game called Titan, which was supposed to be like the follow-up MMO to World of Warcraft. And it was really interesting to hear them talk about how, it really sucks that we fucked up Titan. We couldn't get Titan done. We, you know, like, we just didn't make it happen. But, you know, Overwatch is pretty good.
Look what it turned out well.
It was I wish I could remember where I read that. It was a really good article.
Yeah.
Life gives you lessons, make Overwatch, right? Overwatch is one of my, one of my favorite games of the year, too. I mean, it does. In the context here, it makes 100% sense. All right. Sure. Comments during a recent GameStop investor's call seem to have confirmed motion controls for the upcoming Nintendo Switch console, stating, quote, a movement-related game is more fun for kids. Taking the Joy-Con controllers off, you can really do a lot of interesting things with that in gameplay, end quote. So, are we going to have the Wii all over again with the Switch? Can you imagine that? You got your little controller and you got motion controls? Look, I don't think there's anything wrong with it. And I go back to the old wise man, well, not old, he's the same age as me, Briar Rabbit, who said, there's nothing wrong with more options, man. Mm-mm. You know, if it's something you could turn off and turn, if it's something you could turn off and turn on, maybe some people want to have the motion control. Can you imagine fishing with your Switch, you know? Can you imagine doing the hula with your Switch and
that
actually using
so
motion
weird. Control? Fishing with your Switch?
You know, it's funny, the motion some people controls... have done it have now come into their own now that we've got VR to go with it. Like, all of a sudden now, motion control makes sense. With the PSVR, with the Oculus motion controllers, or with the Vive motion controls. Like, now, okay, this works. But it also needs to be tracked one-to-one, because that was one of the problems that the Wii and the Wii U had, in my opinion, was that basically, I'm making a motion to just hit a button, right? Like, that's all I'm really doing. What I always hoped the Wii would be was, like, they'd give me a sword and I would, you know, be in a sword fight with one-to-one control, but it wasn't capable of that, and this isn't either, so I don't really give a shit. What I want is what the Vive and the Oculus Rift and the Move are giving to me in VR, which is, you know, one-to-one control, so that when I move my hand over here, you know, I'm shooting over here or over there or over there. Like, that is what's cool. This last generation of Move, where it's basically you're shaking it to hit a button, never really
waving dildo. That's glowing.
And for anyone who's offended, you know, because there are people now holding, you know, therapy dogs and stuff because of, you know, the election. If anyone's offended by the way that Briar Rabbit held his gun, let me turn it sideways for the hood. All right, so we equal opportunity, Beastly Thoughts show. Real quick, since you touched on that, it immediately jarred a memory that I had earlier in the week. I bought a new PSVR game. It's called Haven. I don't know if you saw this, but I had to take my camera. I got a video up, actually.
What game was
game.
It? I'm sorry.
And I put my it's called Brookhaven.
Brookhaven,
it's $20. And I put my camera up high in the living room, right up above the 60, and so it could get like a wider berth in the living room. You're 360. There's things coming at you from every direction. You got a flashlight in this hand that you could hit the Move button and turn it into a big blade, like a butcher blade. And you got a gun in this hand. Of course, the guns are upgradable. You get grenades, and you can throw proximity mines at the ground. And there's basically these demons that have been unleashed Doom style. A lot of them actually look like the creatures from Doom. They're coming through bushes. They're coming, you know, down corridors. You shoot their legs off. They're crawling at you, and it's super dark. And you got to use your flashlight to see where they are. And you shoot them in the head. It's very, very, very creepy. It's probably one of the best experiences I've had so far in VR. You don't get any of that disorientating feeling. You're there. You can take a few steps around your living room, and it actually is relayed in real time in the gaming world, and that feels really refreshing. But it's called Brookhaven. I'm really liking it. I think I'm on the fifth level now. There's three waves to each stage, and I'm on the fifth level, and wave three just keeps kicking my ass, but it's a really, really fun game.
And, it looks good. I'm looking at pictures of it right now. I'm surprised this one stuck by me, because I want to play this immediately upon seeing it. Is it scary? Like, is it a horror game, or is it more action?
You play... It's action. I'm not going to lie to you, Briar. It's scary.
You son of a bitch. You tried, too.
Tried to get away with that shit. Not on my watch.
It looks good, though. Like, graphically, it looks pretty good.
It's really great. It's a fun game. It works really well. And when you have those good headphones on, you can tell exactly the direction the next one's coming from. Like, you hear him slinking down the hallway or breathing. Like, you turn and you look and you see him coming. It's really, really awesome. It's cool. A great game.
Now, I'm going to pick this up. Is it download only, or is there...
$20. Yeah, I think it's... I don't know if they have physical copies. I bought it from the PlayStation Store. But it's a lot of fun. It really is. And if you got, you know, a few feet in your living room to walk around in, you know, you're doing 360s, they're coming from all directions, and it's a great game. Our last little bit of news for episode 134 of the Beastly Thoughts Show today. No Man's Sky will be receiving a large new update this week, known as the Foundation Update.
Yeah.
It will include the introduction.
Yeah.
Oh, I never heard of this because I don't have the game. I was too smart to buy it. It will include the introduction of base building and is...
God damn it. Beastly, you son of a bitch. Don't remind me I purchased that game.
It will include the introduction of base building and is the start of a much larger update for things to come. Much larger, like some of the things they told you existed already that didn't exist.
Yeah.
Yo, so, all right. I'm excited for this. I'm not going to lie. I know.
You got to be excited for something.
I know I'm a stupid moron for liking this game, but I do like this game. Like, there's the foundation. It's funny that they call it the Foundation Update, because unfortunately, the foundation of the game, like, you know, it was pretty weak to begin with. You know, yeah. So, like, adding to that foundation, I suppose, is smart. But, like, getting survival mode is pretty interesting in that game. Also, the creative mode, which, I don't know, I'm not, like I don't play creative mode in Minecraft. Like, that doesn't really sound that cool to me. But, like, the fact that you can build a base and they've added a bunch of stuff to it, like, it does sound like they're starting to put a game inside No Man's Sky. And yes. That is very interesting.
That's what's exciting to me.
It's not just a sim... like space farming sim anymore. Well, or hopefully it won't be in the future. I am actually looking forward to checking this out.
Honestly, yeah, well, me too.
Let me just say this, right? I didn't buy the game because initially I didn't see what the draw was. And to be honest, until I see some new stuff, I still don't see what the draw is for me.
Yeah.
But if this new DLC, this new Foundation Update, if the things that they're actually including in the game turn it more into a game versus it's amazing how far you can go in space and the limited planets. If they turn it into an actual game, I'm definitely going to pick it up because I was excited for the tech. I still think the tech is some of the most amazing technology in the video game, world right now.
Yeah.
This algorithm that was created, whether or not it was stolen or not, who knows? But this technology that was created that, you know, procedurally generates, you know, unlimited planets is totally amazing. And, you know, to see a talented developer use some of this technology in the future. Is really going to change the gaming world. I think it's really exciting to see what the possibilities are.
I'm hoping that game will expand into something that we all want to actually put some time in. I put like 20 or 30 hours into that game when it came out, and that time was enjoyable for me.
Yeah, same.
Did you get it on PS4 or Steam? Because some people put 30 or 40 hours in and still PS4. Got a full refund. If you were, damn it, you could have got a refund, Briar. I'm just kidding. Everybody on Steam got a refund for that shit. Guys.
Can you not get refunds for games on PS4?
You can, but it's very limited. It's a one-time basis.
You gotta give Shuhei Yoshida a blowjob or some crap. I've only done it once.
Whoa. Okay.
But let me tell
you
this.
I'm not going to those lengths to get a refund. One time.
Yeah, you call him, and the Johnson comes right through the phone. You're like, holy shit. I actually called and got a refund for a PlayStation Vita game because I ended up getting the physical copy. At the same time, my wife was buying the downloaded version. And so I was like, I got two versions of this game, and I called him and let him know I had two copies. And I said, sir, we're going to extend you this courtesy just one fucking time. Don't ever call us back for some bullshit like this again. Can I help you with anything else today? I
said, oh, this is some bullshit. You got two PlayStations. We know you do. You've been sharing every game. About time every you game. Paid for two. Shit. Don't come up in here telling me that we ripped you off. We know what you're up to over there, Mr. Beastly Gamer.
Right.
And we know what you did with your PS3, too. You ain't fooling nobody.
It was him. Briar was the one on the phone. Mr. Beastly Gamer.
He didn't slide his Johnson through the phone, did he? Hopefully not.
It was Briar. Look, on PS4, the movies that you actually bought and paid for, you don't own them anymore. You don't own like a digital version. You can't download it. You got to stream it. So, if you buy a movie on your PS3, you download that movie right to your PS3's hard drive. You can watch it offline anytime you want. On the PS4, all my movies are now in the fucking cloud, even though I paid for them. So if I want to watch, you know, some of the movies I've actually paid for in the past, it's got to stream directly from the PlayStation Network. What if I'm not around a place where I have access to the internet? I can't watch a film that I paid for. So I've been fucking scammed by you, Sony.
Yep.
This is bullshit, look, man.
Beastly.
I can't stand
it. We know what you did with that PS3. We know.
We know.
And we're coming. We ain't giving you shit. Ever. To download again. We'll be streaming everything to you from now on.
You want us to help you out? Too bad, bitch.
Giving you a downloadable version? No, sir. No, sir. And that Vita? Oh, shit.
Yeah, good luck.
I'll be pirating the hell out of my shit. Look, I got five PS3s, man. Two of them are not jailbroken, okay? Two of them are legit.
Two out of five ain't bad, right?
Two out of five, that's a bad ratio, though.
Two out of five ain't bad, okay? Good. Yeah.
I'm surprised they didn't call the cops on you.
Hold on.
You got the audacity to call us and ask for your money back?
How dare you?
Fuck this. We're calling the cops.
Let's fucking call the cops on VC right now.
Brian, you gonna give us some ideas. I ain't gonna call someone. We saw episode 134. Sir, we'd like to have your address so we can send you this game a physical copy for free. All right. Are you the VC gamer? Shit.
No.
He lives in Connecticut.
There's an 18-year-old kid over there. That's the VC gamer right over there.
The cops got him.
My son's such a dingleberry, he'd be happy to. Oh, yeah, I'm the Beastly Gamer. All right, so I'll see you in a couple of years. Okay. Yeah,
don't worry. They got good meals in there. He'll be good.
Only could have sold
them. You say you've been trying to lose weight and get in shape? All the oatmeal cream pies and push-ups you could muster, son. Enjoy yourself. So that was the show, and it's been a great show.
It was a good show.
I knew it, man.
We're on a podcast at the end there. I don't know what happened.
I called it at the beginning during the pre-show, and we were... You know, before we all got dressed, I told you guys, this is going to be an epic, epic show. Breyer's been getting ready for his rough and tumble audience. He said, with Donald Trump becoming a new president, he's growing out his beard. Mm-hmm. In protest, he's not fucking having it anymore, okay? So the next time you see Breyer, he's going to have an afro down here and up here. It's going to be
if I could grow an afro, it would have happened already. Trust me. I've told you my character creation mantra, right? If there's an afro,
use
you
it.
Choose it. Done. There is no other option.
I swear, he really said that too, y'all.
It's true. You know, it's if true. There is an afro, you put use that it. Fucking thing on. I was playing The Witcher 3, and I found the place where you get your haircut. I'm like, please be an afro. Please have an afro. Please have an afro.
Geralt with an afro.
Big ass white afro. Every cutscene in that game would have been 90% better from there on out.
I'm going to get around to that game too, Briar. I promise. As soon as I'm done with Dishonored 2, such a good game. Briar, and before we leave, I want to say, don't, overexert yourself, man. You've been playing a lot of fucking games. By the time you get back to Destiny, you're going to think you're playing Dig Dug. You're not going to know what the hell's going on anymore.
Dig Dug. You know, we got the Sparrow Racing League coming soon.
Oh, yeah.
A lot of people are thinking it's going to be on the 6th of December.
And it's only seasonal, right?
Seasonal, yeah.
Just like last time?
Okay. Yeah.
They should keep it. They should allow the Sparrow fans to keep that.
Right.
And Robbie's crying right now.
Let them ride.
All right, boys. That was a good show. Thank you, guys.
Yeah, boys. Yeah.
Thank you, everybody, for watching. We'll be back next week.
See ya.
I love you all.
All of them?
No homo.
There's one of you that he doesn't love. I'll let you figure out who it is.
What the fuck? That's not true.